Unto the Lord be the glory, great things he has done. Unto the Lord be the glory, greater things he will do. Unto the Lord be the glory, great things he has done. Unto the Lord be the glory, greater things he will do. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the grace to be alive today. And we give you glory. As usual, we are gathered to seek your face in times like this. And you have promised us that unto you shall be the gathering of your people. We therefore pray, O God, that you will bless this meeting. You will heal our life. You will heal our land. And you will showcase the beauty of your glory. Thank you, Jesus, that every one of us at the end of this prayer meeting, we will see you and we will go back home rejoicing in Jesus' name. Once again, I want to welcome everyone to this wonderful time in the presence of God, the hour of divine settlement. The hour of divine settlement. Today, we shall be considering a theme. O God, do not hide your face from us. O God, do not hide your face from us. This prayer is a cry of desperation. And you'll find that cry of desperation in Psalm 88. Before I read the text, I just want to say that a time comes in one's life when he feels that God is inactive, God is insensitive to his or her situation. Some even feel like the writer of this psalm that God has decided to join his enemy or allow his enemy to deal with him, or God has completely abandoned him. Some have come to such a situation that they felt that there is no God. Why will he allow a pandemic? Why will he allow his children to pass through terrible situation? But I must say that he is God, and we cannot question him. There are many things we don't really understand, but we do know that in his own time, he will heal us, he will bless us, he will meet us at the point of our needs. Oh God, do not hide your face from us. Psalm 88 and verse 14 says, Lord, why do you cast off my soul? Why do you hide your face from me? I want us to take a deep breath. Whatever situation you are going through, just take a deep breath. Have a reflection on the situation and say these prayers, because at times we need to look at ourselves, look at the situation, now check the situation with the perspective of God. How does God see my situation? And then you pray, O Lord, send help to me in my hour of distress. You can turn that to prayer and pray deep as you pray it in, you breathe it out. Help me in this hour of distress. Help me. Amen. You can also say to God, soothing my soul with the peace of your spirit, that in times like this, my soul is troubled. Just like the psalmist said, that his soul is cast off him. But the truth is that God is working out his purpose in your life. So tell him, soothing my spirit with the peace of your spirit. Say that prayer deeply and see God sending relief into your heart. You can also say this prayer, Lord, I have exhausted my energy. I have exhausted all my strength. Give me strength from above. Can I hear you say the prayer? I have exhausted my energy. I have used my strength and they have failed me. Give me strength from above. We all need it. I tell you, we all need it. The life situation is in phases and sizes. You might think others are not going through the same thing you are going through. Theirs might be in different form. But when you ask the Lord to breathe the breath of life unto you, to give you strength to carry on, trusting that God is working his purpose out in your life. In Psalm 25, verses 1 and 2, Psalm 25, 1 and 2, that song, unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. You can take it again. Unto thee, O Lord. Unto thee, O Lord. Do I lift up my soul? I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord. Unto thee, O Lord. Do I lift up my soul? Yes, Lord. Oh, my God, my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies triumph over me. Listen to me, my beloved brother and sister. God is still concerned. God is still involved and he will do something about the situation. He will work it out in his own time. When we take a closer look at that psalm, you will find that the psalmist approached God for deliverance. In fact, he saw God as his deliverer. Verses 1 and 2 of Psalm 88 says, O Lord, God of my salvation. Some other version says, God of my deliverance. I have cried out day and night before you. Let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry. Let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry. He called God his salvation. He called God his deliverer. He approached God with that confidence. But you find out that when he came out from the place of prayer, And he moved on outside. Maybe he began to do his day-to-day activities. And he felt his prayers are not answered. And he decided, or he started to derail. That's how we are. I usually say something, most of the time we say our prayers in the closets. We go out and we forget what we have spoken to God. And then we began to do some other things. I want to say the moment you said those prayers, the devil heard those prayers. And he took those prayers seriously. And because he took this prayer seriously, immediately he starts to work against it. You must stand up and be strong. You must believe that God is involved. And you must be focused, trusting that he will do it. And in verse 6 and 7, I will enjoin you to go and read through. But as we look at this psalm, we will see that the psalmist, the one who wrote this, is also human, just like you and I. And so, look at it. In verses 6 and 7, he alleged God. He saw God as an offender, one who has offended him. You have laid me in the lowest pit. He was referring to God that he called his deliverer. In darkness and in the depths, your wrath lies heavy upon me, and you have afflicted me with all your waves. Even if it was the devil that afflicted him, but now he's talking about God. God cannot do evil if we have not turned evil ourselves, if our lives have not been taken over by Satan, if we are not engaged in sinful habits. He alleged God. But I want us to understand that God understands all of these things. God sees us as human. And so, the point I'm trying to make here is that as situation unfolds, even after we have called upon God, there is no crime in mentioning this prayer over and over again that God, even though I am saying something different, I know you are in this with me. You are my deliverer. I know you will heal me. I know your ears are inclined to my prayers. I pray for as many whose hearts are heavy, that God's power of deliverance will come upon you in the name of Jesus. Your expectation shall not be cut short. Then in verse 14 came that prayer. Lord, why have you cast off my soul? Why have you turned your face away from me? I see this as querying God, you know. I see a man who capitulates. I see a man who is drowning. I see a man who has budged to pressure. I pray God will give us strength. I see a man who has given up on his expectation, as many of us who has given up. I pray for you there shall be restoration of strength in the name of Jesus. I want us to turn this part also to prayer. I want you to, whether you want to kneel, whether you want to stand, wherever you are, I want you to make this decree. I refuse to accept defeat on the battleground. I, Benson Adekunle Odude, refuse to accept defeat on the battleground. I shall be victorious. I confess that the Lord is my light And so every darkness before me, I command to give way. God is my salvation. You can say that to yourself. God is my salvation. God is my deliverer. And no power of the enemy will be able to pull me down. No power of the enemy will pull down any member of my family, because I know God is my light. Say to yourself, I shall not fear what man shall do. The Lord is my strength. The Lord is the strength of my life. I shall not be afraid of anything. In the name of Jesus, I decree and I pray for you that every aspect of your life that is under torment and aggression from the devil, God will bring his salvation and deliverance upon you in the name of Jesus. The Lord will arise and he will fight your battle for you in the name of Jesus. Because when it is time for God to begin to work out his will, when it is time for God to begin to work out his purpose, I tell you, every power contrary to God, militating, fighting you, they will be subdued in the name of Jesus. Amen. You can also continue and say, I confess that in time of trouble, God shall hide me in his pavilion. Again, I confess that in times of trouble, God shall hide me in his pavilion. Haven't you heard that the word of God says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runs into it and they are saved. I pronounce salvation into your life in the name of Jesus. You will decree, in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. You are hidden in the name of Jesus. You are hidden in the name of Jesus. No weapon of the enemy fashioned against you shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up against you shall be condemned in the name of Jesus. The Lord will set you up upon a rock. I decree. I said, God, say it to yourself, will set me up upon a rock in the name of Jesus. That rock is Jesus. That rock is Jesus. And when you are set up upon the rock, no one will be able to touch you. And so you are untouchable. The Bible decree, touch not my anointed, and do my prophet no harm. Say to yourself, I am the Lord's anointed. I am the Lord's anointed. I am the Lord's anointed. And I am the Lord's anointed. Nobody is permitted to harm me. Whatever affliction I may be going through now, it will end up for my good. In the name of Jesus. God is aware of it. God is aware of it. Thank you, Father. We will still continue in that prayer. I demand spiritual weapon. Hallelujah. This is an aggressive prayer. I demand spiritual weapon from above to be released against my enemy in the name of Jesus. The enemy of my soul. When I talk about the enemy, I talk about the devil, I talk about his cohorts, I talk about all his agents, and I say that the weapon from above, the weapon of God, unleash upon the enemy of my soul, and I decree total freedom from Satan's exploitation. In the name of Jesus, I decree total freedom from Satan's exploitation. And I pray same for you. I pray for your family. Whatever it is that is an aggression from the pit of hell, we decree this moment that you begin to regain your freedom from satanic exploitation. In the name of Jesus, every chain and shackles that the enemy is using on your husband, on your wife, on your children, on your business, let them be loose now in the name of Jesus. That song says, our Lord God, that made the heaven and the heart by the outstretched power. My Lord God, that made the heaven and the heart by the outstretched hand. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Nothing is too difficult for thee. Great and mighty God, great in power, mighty in thee, nothing, absolutely nothing is too difficult for thee. Do you believe the wordings of that song? that God makes the heaven and the earth, his outstretched arm can deliver you. He is your deliverer. Do you believe? I encourage you that every word of that song, do you believe that nothing is too difficult for God to handle? All you need to do now is, God, I hand them over to you. I believe. Whatever the devil likes, let him do. I believe. Whatever the enemy likes, let them do. I believe. God is in control of my life. God is in charge. And I know whatever I experience now is for a moment. I trust in God. I stand upon the rock of salvation, and it is well with me. You know, as I begin to round up, and I want you to look at this with me. The same thing happened to Jesus Christ. According to the prophecy written ahead of time in Psalm 22. And Jesus Christ showed us example there. In that Psalm 22 verse 1, that prophetic statement before Jesus gave up the ghost was that, my God, my God, verse 22, verse 1, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? People of God, Jesus said this, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It was the situation at that time. But don't forget, at the same time, that same Jesus prayed for his enemy on the cross. That same Jesus said to God, let your will be done. What the word of God is telling you is that Jesus has passed through the same and is feeling the same way you are feeling. And all you need to do is that, God, I hand this situation over to you. Let your will be done. Jesus said, let your will be done. He did not turn to his human enemy or flesh enemy and begin to count them one by one and awaiting their destruction. The power of the enemy is the devil who is behind whatever. And so what is left for you is to put your trust in him. If Jesus said this same statement, why have you forsaken me? Why are you far from helping me? Recently, I was praying with my wife. There was an issue we were praying about. And I said to God, I don't have any other thing I worship. I don't know any other God. I don't even know of any other prophets. You are the only one I know. And because you are the only one I know, and because I don't want evil for any other person, I desire progress for everyone, except if it was otherwise, on this matter, have your way. And that's just the issue. You don't begin to put your problem on some other person as though they are the one who is the root cause of your misfortune. Give everything to Jesus, and you will find that he will come down to deliver you. We shall be delivered in the name of Jesus. The power of God will bring deliverance upon us in Jesus' name. You need to take notes if you read verse 22, because our time is well spent already. Psalm 22, that same psalm, what I really found out that Jesus did is what I want to give to you. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. Verse 23, you who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, glorify him. We go to verse 25. My praise shall be of you in the great assembly. I will pay my vows before those who fear him. talking about the great assembly is talking about children of God worshiping together and being renewed in power and strength. It's talking about you declaring the name of God. I tell you, you should not forsake the assembly of the people of God. You should not be afraid of pandemic or any form of diseases, especially when we are gathered together, because the name of the Lord is mighty to subdue and suppress any pandemic. And so when you declare the name of God in the assembly of the people of God, when you praise Him, you cannot compare the praises in the assembly of God's people to wherever you may be. And so what we're saying in essence is that three things are very, very key for you to bring back the face of God. Hallelujah. For you to get God's attention. Very, very important. I will declare thy name, the name of the Lord, both inside the church and outside. Whatever your situation is, people will ask you, why? You are always singing with all this pressure around you. You can glorify the name of God. It is not me, it is Jesus. Hallelujah. When you say this, God's name is glorified, and you will see Him in action on your behalf. When you praise Him all the time, people don't find you unnecessarily aggressive. People don't find you shouting all the time. All they find is the joy of the Lord in you in praises. You will see God paying quick attention to your situation. Verse 25 tells us, I will pay my vow before them that fear Him. Whatever you have declared in secret as a promise, God, I want to do this for you. You need to declare it before the people of God. In fact, sometimes some of those vows can be paid ahead of time. And that's how God will know that you are a serious-minded person. Those were the things Jesus did. Ahead of time, He spoke about what He was to do. He told His disciples. And when it was time for Him to pay the final price, everything was easy. I want us to close with one or two prayers. And I trust that the Lord will perfect all that concerns us. I want you to pray that God, in your hands I commit myself. Deliver me from the wicked one. You find that in Psalm 72 verse 12. Rescue me, O God. Rescue me and help me from my oppressor. Tell God to oppress your oppressor. As many that oppresses me or is oppressing me, oppress them. Oppress them. In the name of Jesus. So Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 4. Isaiah 43 and verse 4 tells us where God has placed you as a precious person. You will go home. You will stay where you are. Find time to pray it into your life. For I am the Lord your God. Verse 4, since you were precious in my sight, you have been honored, and I have loved you. Therefore, I will give men for you and people for your life. You can turn that to prayer. The Father, I am precious in your sight. Father, I know I am honored. Lord, I know you love me. Therefore, give men for me. And give nations for my life. So shall it be in the name of Jesus. Let us pray. I will never let you go unless you bless me. I will never let you go unless you bless me. I will never let you go unless you bless me. I will never let you go unless you bless me. My blessings, my future, my life is in your hands. Let that be your prayers. And I know only you can turn my situation around. Lord, we thank you because beyond what we'll expect, you will do for us. For a time, your face was out of Jesus. And he prayed the prayer in Psalm 22, verse 1. And when it was time, you brought him into your bosom. Lord, we know it is time for you to visit whoever is listening to the sound of my voice, for you to turn the situation around. Thank you because we know testimonies will follow this to your glory. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.